All right. So we were told to give a 20-minute presentation, but it seems as though I have about an hour. Right? Let's get started. My name is Jerry Walker. I'm going to tell you a little bit of who I am for only two reasons. Number one, I'm not a native of St. Louis. I'm actually from South Bend, Indiana. I went to Ball State University with my master's and my bachelor's degree. And when I first moved here, the word Hoosier has a different meaning for me than for people from St. Louis. Found out the hard way. Hoosier to me, the theory that we have in Indiana, that's the sound of the Nets make when the basketball goes through the hoop, being, you know, we're from Indiana. The second reason is, and you know, I started in healthcare IT consulting, but also because I never got over the fact that I had one shot at being a millionaire. And when we started that startup company and when we were working on it, we were on our second round of money, and the internet busted. So if anybody went through that process, here I am. I was a 26-year-old young man thinking, yes, I'm the next Bill Gates. Yeah. See how that went. So, I'm here to talk about the transformation of the city government. It's very interesting here for the city of St. Louis. For the past, up until about a little over a year and a half ago, I was a director of IT for a major not-for-profit based out of Indianapolis, Family Development Services, which just so happens I ran into somebody that remembered me from back there from CenturyLink. She remembered me being there because for 6 years I actually worked out of my home in St. Louis, so I was always traveling back and forth. But during that time, I got to meet Treasurer Tashara Jones, and she came along and said, hey, you know, I really need some help over here. We want to make some changes. I'm not sure if we can do that with the current IT infrastructure. I know what I want to do, but not really sure what I want to do or how to do it. And so to do that, one of the reasons why I decided to work for the Treasurer was because, as everybody knows in IT, if you're going to make a real transformation in any department, in any organization, it must start from the top. So if you've got a leader that is willing to make those changes and willing to move forward, it makes people like myself job easier, because there's not a whole lot of convincing I got to do. So with that, her vision was to leverage technology to update the office to the 21st century. She wanted to update the parking technology, which is very unique in the city, because I never saw, but never knew that there's no other city that I know of where the Treasurer is responsible for on-street and off-street parking, as well as the financing, bonds, and treasury of a city. So I don't know why those two things go together here in St. Louis, but they do. So that also, she understood that she needed to have PCI and some security compliance. Not really sure how to do that, but she knew she needed it. She wanted to streamline process for both citizens and Parking Violations Bureau, and she wanted to create that IT department, which the Treasurer's Office is in its history has never had. So to do that, again, as long as you had the top person for change, you know, needed that leadership, then, you know, it, to me, didn't seem that big of a problem. Well, obviously I was wrong. So, parking on what? So if you remember, before they did the new parking, they had these dumb meters. So the meters were just basically LCD display meters, and you could only put a coin in it, and it was all mechanical. So, you know, it was like changing, you know, even when you had to do auditing or any type of that thing, it was all just mechanical pieces that you pulled out, and that was basically it. The parking enforcement, which are the POs that you see walking around, they had these old handhelds that were huge. They didn't really do anything except for just print a ticket. They would just put the information in and they'd print a ticket. And there was no connection, no wireless, anything, just this big old piece of equipment, and all they did was print out tickets. The ticketing system had no system check, so there was no way for, you know, to check whether or not, you know, when the PO wrote the ticket, whether or not that person actually paid or not, except for what they could see visually on the actual system itself, on the actual meter. There were no meter dedicated ticketing. There was no tickets not viewable until the next day. So if you got a ticket as a consumer and you went to go challenge that ticket immediately, or you didn't think you deserved that ticket, you could not find out whether you could not see that ticket until the next day. So you couldn't call about it yet. You would have to wait at least 24 hours. So one of the things that Ms. Jones was looking at was making sure that she felt like, you know, if the consumers are going to pay for it, they absolutely need to know, you know, what they're paying for, and if they feel like they should have been given a ticket, they should be able to see that as well. So the back end office for that system, and then right now, this is just part of the deal. Back end office was old. It took one day to update from point A to point B when it came to the handhelds. Call for reports, you know, were non-existent. Parking violation bureau could not go onto a system and look up anything. They literally had to call into the third-party vendor and say, hey, we need a report that shows us this, and they had to wait for that person to create the report, to send it, and then they would have it. There was also in collections, auditing was very hard to do because it was all mechanical, handheld, and you had to trust whoever pulled the coins out was actually putting all the coins in, and also the back end, you know, when the money got transferred, everything was being done correctly. No auditing. There was also a loss of revenue during that time. So then, when I say loss of revenue, again, that's what happened to the money. Why is there so many variances on, you know, what should have came in, what's not there? Servicing was only physical. Data was late, flat, narrow, you know, not much information whatsoever. And consumers ticketing, when they got ticketed, it was their word against ours. So if you remember if anybody ever got a ticket and called down to the PVB, Parking Violation Bureau, you know, basically your word against theirs. I didn't deserve a ticket. Well, prove to us that you don't. There was no way to do that. And everything was coins only, and you know, consumers at that time, you know, and here traveling back and forth to Indianapolis was already way ahead. So in Indianapolis, it was all paid by phone, credit card, you know, all of this stuff. So here it was, you know, what consumers wanted but did not have. So how did that actually look for us at the time where it was parking over? So basically all you had was this one access to parking enforcement tickets, and you could pay online at that time, but the user access was, and user, when I mean user, I mean the office users. All they had access was just to that back-end system, and that was just for parking enforcement tickets again, and that's only where they would place the reports, and they would pull the reports out from there, and there was a little bit of ticketing information for other violations that they could get. But, you know, not much else. So, what do we have to do? So now this whole thing with the treasurer's office was twofold. Again, we were talking about parking, and then we were also talking about, you know, office systems as well in the back end. So, and they kind of end up tying it together somewhat, you know. And there's a whole other speech I could do just on the office back system side that we had to do. So what we ended up doing is get smart single multi-space meters. And what did those meters provide? They provide cellular services directly from the meters, and they provided coins, cash, credit, debit card. So you can choose any way you wanted them to pay. And it was all wireless, and some places were parking meters, and some were actually parking spaces, and you had one kiosk where you would go pay on there. You had back office, was a lot easier to access. So now what you have is real-time access to data. So now the office users can now go in there real-time and see exactly when somebody paid. So if you were to pay for a parking meter now, they can actually go in within seconds later and see what time you paid, what you paid for, and how you paid it, whether it was with coins, cash, or credit, or debt. The other great thing that happened, which they didn't have before, was that the meters give live alerts. So paper jams, coin jams, meters malfunctioning or anything like that was now all real time. Where in the past, the only time they would see it is if they physically went on site and saw that there was something wrong with the meter. So if you remember, you would go to, you would park and the meter was there and it wouldn't work. But that meter probably did not work for months and sometimes maybe even a year before it even got fixed. It wouldn't know about it. So those all became live. You can see everything you need to see in the back office. Parking enforcement, you have live access to system on handhelds, which was great. check systems for payment parking before payment before ticketing and picture uploaded tickets. So what that meant was this. So when the PO would go on the site and they would actually create a ticket, what it did was once they created the ticket, it would do number one, it would check to see whether or not that person had paid. And if it didn't see that it paid, they would check, they would make create the ticket. And then once they hit submit, it would check once again whether or not that person had paid. And then if it did, it would send the ticket on, they would have to take a picture. It wouldn't allow them to do it without a picture. They would have to take a picture of what the violation was. They would send it up. And then within seconds, it was uploaded and the user could see it. If the consumer came to see that the ticket was given, they could literally make a phone call and get an answer right away if whether or not they deserve a ticket. But what happened was something very unique. And we'll get to that. So audit, system audits became live with update of revenue and easy reporting variance, easier to track losses. So with the real-time information that started happening after that, what it allowed us to do was that as the systems were being audited or as the systems were being collected, what they had to do now was the system would already tell us what that meter made. So we already knew what the revenue was. So there was no way that you could get any type of variance because once they pulled it, we knew what was coming in at that point. Before then, we had no idea. But now we do. So if there was any variances, it was easy to go back and say, hey, there was something missing here. We need to figure out what happened. So it made it very easy to do that piece of it. The other thing that was implemented was pay by phone. So that's the Park Mobile, Park Louis Mobile app. So now what you can do is you can actually pay for your parking using your phone, which became very great because what happened, especially for some of us, was that if you go into a meeting, you can turn around and use the Park Mobile or the Park Louis, and then if the meeting ran over, you can just pay, it would alert you, and you can pay directly again from your phone without ever having to go back to your car. So that was some things that we did in the new parking, and what does that look like now? So now, as you see, what it did was it provided this whole new way of accessing everything. So we had the parking on IPS, which are the parking meters, and we had the Park Mobile along with the parking enforcement and ticket back in. And now what happened is that everybody can connect to it in real time, all at the same time. So it was a vastly different way of thinking for the organization, which was true when you're thinking about organizational change, leadership change, or organizational change management, that type of thing. This dictated a lot of that, because now those departments had to totally rethink about how they reacted. Now, the great thing about that, this whole new system, was that the unexpected but expected turnaround was that in this past year, parking had over 100,000 less tickets than they had in the past, and that was because they can now get the information real time and see it real time and see when the ticket actually should have been paid. What it also did was users were able to provide on the spot their receipt. Because if you paid by phone, you had a receipt emailed to you. If you paid by the meter, you received it. If you paid by your credit card, your credit card showed it. So it was no longer your word against ours, it was show it. And the ticket got erased. Because sometimes systems do make mistakes. So, the next one that came up was off-street parking. So that's the garages. So again, threw me off a little bit of not understanding how the treasures, how the city of St. Louis has, the treasurer has parking. So there are a number of parking garages. So what we ended up having to do was, so the old off-street parking was, they were isolated system, decentralized management, one person control all, consumer frustration, long ways for changes, and not scalable at all. So when I say one person control, literally if the system that went down, there was only one person that could come out and fix the system. So if that person was on vacation, that garage basically was down for months. That actually happened when I first, not too long after I started working there, one of the garages went down, the guy that could get to it was in Jamaica. So the parking lot was literally down for a week and a half, because he was gone for 2 weeks. So what did that mean? That meant the gates had to stay up, and it was free parking for 2 weeks. So it was free, so it was no revenue being generated in one of the biggest garages that the treasurer had. So, the current narrative, this is where it gets interesting. So this is where I have a lot of funny stories that I can't tell here. The network was not PCI compliant, right? To get that done was a high cost. At the time, they were told it was over $400K one-time investment and $38,000 a year to do this. Now, grant you, this is the treasurer at the time before I got there working with the current City Hall IT department and what they said it would need to get done. So, this is interesting. And I'll talk more about that in a minute on why that become that why that started a whole lot of other things within the department. There was no credit cards, it was non-existent, most of them had cash only. And this is what the old network looked like at that time, because this network was going to dictate how the treasurer moved forward on making all of those things she wanted to happen. So as you can see, it was a city network. It was a city private network, access to the internet, and everybody had T1 lines and you know, firewalls, and it was just MPLS internet traffic, right? Simple, MPLS, you know, everybody's seen, most everybody's seen this, everybody know what this is. Basically, you're dealing with just networks. So, we had to move forward because of the things that we need to make happen, and what dictated on that is we needed to do credit cards. They wanted to do credit cards, they wanted people to pay more than with just cash. So that dictated having to change our whole view on our current network, because that also dictated that we had to be PCI compliant. Within 6 months of becoming PCI, but not PCI, remember, within 6 months of implementing this, we turned into a third-tier merchant for credit cards. So if anybody is in the PCI industry or, you know, in the IT for any of the banks and credit cards, you know, with you know, being considered a class 3 merchant for credit cards. So the data center, what this allowed us to do was we were able to create one data center and put all of our parking in that one data center. So it was all centralized, it was easy to manage, it was easy to get going, it was easy to access, troubleshoot, reporting became easier, faster response, scalable, easy upgradable, QR code reservations. So all of these new things became available for us when we moved into this new technology. It also forced us to become PCI compliant. So how do we do that? We ended up doing a hyper-converged system. We went with a $75,000 one-time investment and a $9,000 year, which was a stark difference on what they were originally told. They were originally told it was $400,000 and $38,000 a year. We were able to do this for only $75,000 one-time investment and only having to spend $9,000 a year. Big difference. Credit card became part of the system, pay on foot, both at the gate and at the booth, both on foot, gate or booth. So you could literally, which, you know, this is something we're not going to, you know, the treasurer does not want to do, we literally can manage all of the garages from one place. You could have one person sitting in the data center and control all of the garages, booths, without anybody actually being in the booth if necessary. But I think the city is used to having somebody at the booth to talk to, so we left people in the booth. But you can drive directly up to the actual gate and pay right at the gate, or you can pay on foot. So this is what the new street, off-street parking, and what we just, and where we went to. What does that look like now? So, because we had to become PCI compliant, now mind you, here's a funny story. For us to become PCI compliant, the way we knew we had to change this was because the question came up when we asked the current people that work on the network, said, hey, we need to know where this switch belongs to on the network and what's that IP address. The answer we got back was like, we don't know. We have to find it. So in anything that would come PCI compliant, that is not a good answer, to not know what that switch is connected to, just know that it's there. So we literally, had to walk and follow the lines there. So I go into the ground and figure, well, let's try and see if we can find the other side, you know, and follow through the building until we found the switch. That's how we had to find some of our network. So right then and there, I knew, okay, so we can't sit on that network. We had to build a whole new network, which we did. We built a whole different network. And what that network looks like now is as you can see, you have there with the, and to become PCI compliant, we did this, we did the whole infrastructure change. We put in new routers, new firewalls, you know, new telecom equipment, new everything, and to create this right here. So it was a stark difference from $400,000 to $75,000, and from $38,000 to $9,000 a year. So we were able to accomplish that. We were able to do PCI compliance, and as I spoke earlier, you know, pin testing, so your external vulnerability, your internal vulnerability testing, all of that stuff we have to do, and we currently do now, and it's always ongoing because we're always checking to see if our network can get hacked. The PCI network is actually a VLAN and segregated off from everybody else, so no one else can see it but those that are on that network, and that's for all revenue-generating equipment. So this is what it looks like now. So what did that do? So by creating this whole new network, becoming PCI compliant, something that the city could not, you know, the city, first time the city has actually went to go into this area where they were PCI compliant, being able to provide this type of service on a grand scale across the city was the first time they had seen this. And what did that call, what did that actually cause? So it caused a regional change. So places like Clayton, so in Clayton, if you notice, they have the same type of meters in Clayton now, and they're putting those up. Because what happened was the Clayton administration came to us and said, hey, a lot of our people, a lot of our constituents in the city are saying, hey, why don't we have those same type of meters that they have in the city in Clayton? So we explained how we did it, and they started doing it as well. East St. Louis did the same thing. They asked the same thing, so we're showing them how to do that as well. Park Mobile, which this was different. So when we implemented the pay by phone, what we did not expect is for a lot of the different, because the city does not own all of the parking lots or all of the parking garages. Those companies that do own those have also implemented Park Mobile as well. Once we implemented ours and saw people using it, which sometimes we get phone calls from their stuff like, hey, it didn't work. So that was interesting. So that was another change that happened. What it also did for us was it streamlined our processes. Consumers PVB can access payment at the same time, as I explained earlier. It made it easier for people to access information. It made it easier for people to look up their ticketing and also show pictures of what the ticketing was for. Eliminated guesswork, lowered ticketing, eliminated revenue discrepancies. Now, just a little bit about the back end that we had to do. Because this dictated the change, it also dictated how we worked internally. So internally, they were still working on Office 2000. And we had to change that. So how do we change that? So instead of paying for a whole new Microsoft Office suite for every single person we had, we just went to Office 365, which made it a lot easier. We currently updated our PBX, and we're currently on using our security. We've also had to upgrade our security. So, what's next? Data analytics is what's next for us, and that's where we see a lot of changes for us in getting mass amount of data. So, that's all I have. Any questions?
Yeah. Are you guys concerned now that you have credit card readers on parking meters or whatever about skimmers and stuff like that? Do you have anything in place to prevent that?
Yes. So that's part of a PCI compliance issue. That is something that we are worried about. So daily, our technicians go to every single one of the meters, and that's part of the routine check they have to do. So they have to check and see whether or not there's a skimmer on there. They have to check the system. They have to make sure all that is working. The good news for us, though, is that the system will actually alert us to when that's happening. So if anybody messes with that credit card and do anything to it, put anything on top of it, it shoots us an alert to let us know that it has been tampered with or it's been changed. So yes, that is something we look into, and it is a big one. Yes?
Are you moving towards chip cards?
Moving towards?
Chipped cards?
So that's a whole other issue. The problem with chip card is that's based on the on EMV. problem with that is the U.S. has not quite taken a stance on what that should look like. The European you know, countries have, but European countries are more consumer-based laws for that type of stuff. You know, unfortunately for us, the U.S. is not. I'm sorry, what's that again?
You've lost money on ticket revenue, mm-hmm. and you've gained revenue on, you know, just convenience.
Correct.
You speak to that, or differentials, or are you making a lot more money now?
I would say we're making more money, but we are projecting more than we have in the past, yes. So even though we're not doing as many tickets, that did allow us to make more.
Last question.
Yes, but that would go towards our partner administrator who has done that. But yes, we have, and we did make more by making this change. So no, because I wasn't here when they had it from before, so I don't remember. I don't know off the top of my head, but I do know that they did. So, yep. Thank you.
We're going to change the schedule just a little tiny bit since we are